When I grew up, I loved to play games with my sister. I loved to beat my sisters at games, but I also loved to play them. And we played all kinds of them. And one of our favorites was this, the game of life. How many played life when you were younger? Oh, man, there's a lot of you. All right. It's a crazy game, right? And it's evolved over time. When we played, how many? Okay, this is going to date you, all right? How many remember on the board game of life the little space called Revenge? It was in green. Do you remember that? Only a few of you. A few more. Okay. That was the best space. They took it away. I mean, you could sue people for $100,000. That was the best space on the board. Now they kind of made it like politically correct life, right? So life was really fun. I loved spinning the spinner. Didn't it sound like the little card you'd put in the back spoke of your tire? Oh, that was great until it went off the track. Then you get set. Oh, that was the worst. Game of life. You get to pick your car. You get to put the little pink, blue pieces in. You go wherever you want. It's just an awesome game, and it taught me so much about life. It taught me so much about life as a little kid. I mean, it was fun to pretend, wasn't it? Now we're going through it for real. How do you like it now? I mean, you had to, back then, you were like, payday, that's awesome, and bills, now it's like, payday, that means I have to work every day. And bills, yuck, but it taught us things like you probably ought to have auto insurance and fire insurance. That's important. You probably ought to have that because if you don't, you're going to land on the space and you're going to have to pay big time. So those are good. And you want money because there's lots of expenses out there, right? In fact, you want money because that's how you win the game. You want to make it to millionaire estates. You don't want to end up in countryside acres. Come on, that's where the poor people go. And I hear the food is terrible. We want to win at life. And it teaches us how to win. And I imagine that all those, I still have communion. All those life lessons that there wasn't enough juice in the cups. All right, come on. Those life lessons. You want to make sure that you have enough at the end. And having babies is easy. All you have to do is put the little pegs in there. They don't even cost you anything. It's so. In fact, the more babies, the better. As long as you have room in the little car. Wonder how many of these life lessons that I've had to unlearn or that have set me up for disappointment over time, right? Because life lessons are really, really hard when they're real. Can you imagine if we were able to sit down and play the game of life actually with Jesus? What would that game look like? Do you think it'd be different? Let's just imagine that together. Let's pretend that I'm like, all right, let's play the game of life, Jesus. Jesus, I'm so excited you're going to play one of my favorite games. So I'm going to teach you the rules real quick. So first of all, you need to pick out a color card. Red, that's a good choice. Okay, red. So you get to be red, and here's the deal. Right away, you have a decision to make. Jesus, you have to decide whether you're going to start working right away or you take the other path that's a little bit longer, but you get to choose a career you want to work. Well, that's fine, except I played this a lot, and I know that the longer route is actually better because you can get a career like being a doctor. And if you're a doctor or a lawyer, you make lots and lots of money. Well, money is important because you have to buy stuff, and you're going to have expenses. It actually is the point of the game. You need money to win. You want to get to countryside estates. Trust me on this. You want to work? That's fine. You work. Okay, so you can start working. All right, the first thing you've got to do, Jesus, after you started working, is you're going to come to the church. You have to stop. Everybody stops. I'm not sure why, but you got to get married. So, you know what? Let's just skip that part. Jesus, you don't have to get married. That's kind of weird, so forget that. We're just going to go on. Next, we're going to buy a house. What do you mean you don't want a house? Okay, you have no place to lay your head. I forgot about that part. So, okay, we'll skip the house too. Well, the rest of the game, Jesus, is like this. You earn money as you pass payday, and you pay bills, and you get babies, or not get babies. You know, this game of life really isn't how you did life, is it? It's kind of weird, isn't it? This really isn't for you. And by the way, what happened to all the money I gave you? Oh, you gave it away. Of course you did. You see, the game of life just wouldn't work for Jesus, would it? Because he plays by a whole different set of rules than we do. Right? In fact, if we turned the tables and Jesus was going to teach us how to do life, I imagine the rules that he would give would look so much different, wouldn't they? Because the game that we're used to playing isn't the way that Jesus says ought to be the way we play. He would turn the tables on us entirely. And he would say to us, look, here's how you win at the game of life. You win at the game of life by losing. That's the goal. To lose. And you're like, Jesus, no, you don't really mean that. And he says, no, I really mean that. I'm serious. That is how you're supposed to play this. You're supposed to lose. In fact, not only does he teach us, he shows us. The very first thing he does is as he approaches Jerusalem, as he says, I've set my face on Jerusalem, he explains to them what exactly is going to happen, what is next. And he says this, from that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed. That doesn't sound like winning. That sounds like the enemies of Jesus who didn't like him from the very beginning when Jesus started to say things about his true identity, being God's Son and being the Son of God and being the hinting at and then affirming that he is the great I Am or the Messiah. They're like, no, we don't like you. We're going to put you down. And so what Jesus is saying to his closest followers, his disciples, which is what we're supposed to be, right? Following Jesus. He's saying, I am going to let them win. I'm going to let them win. He gives this little bit of hope right after that. And on the third day, be raised to life. So he says, I'm going to die, and then I'm going to come back. Only the disciples probably didn't hear that part. And we know Peter didn't hear that part because Peter starts arguing with Jesus. He took him aside and said, never, Lord, this shall never happen to you. You're not playing the game right. You see, you're intentionally throwing the game. You're supposed to win. You want the most. You want the best. You can't give up. Jesus, though, gets back into Peter's face and says the harshest words that anyone could hear from Jesus, right? Get behind me, Satan. Woo! I'm saying this is like the adversary, the great enemy of God. I'm going to come back to that statement in a minute. He says, you are a stumbling block to me. You don't have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. He's saying, Peter, you think I'm playing the game wrong? You're playing the game wrong. You don't really understand because you have bought into what everyone else is saying and teaching and living. You're playing the rules of life according to groupthink, and I'm telling you, everybody's playing it wrong. I want you to do this differently. Peter, you think I'm wrong. You're wrong. And so we have two worldviews, two major what Jesus says. This is Jesus' view. This is how it ought to be done. And I think that Jesus has some authority on the subject of how we should live. And then you have all of humanity itself, which teaches a whole new set of rules, completely different from God. Isn't that crazy how we as the created can impose upon the Creator how life ought to be done, and yet we find ourselves constantly over in this category trying to do life the way everyone else teaches to do life. The things we learned in life, like success, and you've got to have money and position and power, and oh, status is so important because a doctor, yeah, you're really cool, and you drive that cool car, and you got lots of babies. Everything that we think makes up what life ought to be about as far as winning at the game of life, Jesus turns on its head and says, that's humanity's opinion. I'm telling you, it's different. It doesn't look that way. And he goes on and he tells them, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. I'm going to go die for humanity, and I want you, in a sense, to die as well. It doesn't necessarily mean physical death, but there are things about the way that you're living that just need to go. Need to go. And he says, whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me will find it. Basically, you win at life by losing. And I think that we kind of get this and know this, even though we're all caught up in the same pole that everyone else is. We feel the pressure to be like the rest of humanity. We want to do what they're doing. We see status symbol. We see car you drive. We see house you live in. We see retirement you go. And we see vacations. And we see family. And we see friendships. And we see likes. And we see popularity. We see these things. We compare ourselves to them. And yet, I really think we understand intuitively that God has created us in such a way that if we strip everything away that the world has imposed upon us as what it means to truly win, we get it deep down inside. And here's how I know that. When I watch a movie, and you probably have watched way too many movies lately, Netflix is getting burned up, Prime is getting burned up right now. By the way, Frozen 2 was released last night. I can't believe you're still here. Okay, so we know this is true because we know that we resonate with it when it shows up in movies, and it shows up in movies all the time. I'm going to pull one out, and this will be interesting. Most of you played Life. That's cool. Let's see how many have seen Cars. Pixar's movie, Cars. All right, several. Actually, probably just as many as played Life. I'm impressed. For those that have not seen Pixar's Cars, it's a fun movie. It is about a race car that is named Lightning McQueen, and he's red too. He's a red race car, and he loves speed. He loves winning. He loves a fast life, and it is just, you know, it's fun if you're a boy, especially. You get pumped up. Oh, this is like the boy movie right here. And because it's racing and it's winning, and Lightning McQueen, he's the best, and he's got to win. In fact, he is so close at winning the Piston Cup, he can almost taste it, but because the last race ended in a tie, he has got to race again for that title, and he's so excited, and he's traveling out to California to race it for the Piston Cup, only he gets lost along the way. And ends up in a little town called Radiator Springs. Radiator Springs is not the fast life. It is the slow life. Everything in Radiator Springs is slower. And Mater, the tow truck, is the slowest. And this is driving Lightning McQueen crazy. He can't wait to get out of this town, but he's got to do something because he messed up the town. He's got to fix the town. He can't get out of there quickly, but he's got to get to the race so he can win the Piston Cup. And while he is there, forced to slow down, he discovers something. Friendship. Something that success and speed and winning never afforded him. And in those friendships that were developed, he began to change. And when he finally made it out to California to race in the big race, he is just about to win. And win the Piston Cup. When he sees another race car spin out, and he stops, and he goes back and helps him. And he loses the race. And yet our hearts are completely full. Because while he lost the race, he won at life. And we get that. And we get that every time we watch those kind of movies, because that's what it really means to live. To share, to give, to serve, to not be in this for ourselves, to not put our identity in who we are and the position we're at and how much we make and where we live, but to put our whole identity in Christ and say, I want to be on your terms. I want to do life on your agenda. I want to do it the way you want me to do life. I want to change this way that I do it. And every time we watch the ending, we feel that and we connect with that. And yet we then go back to our way of living. We climb and we succeed and we make the money and we have the status symbols. Right now, we've been forced to slow down, haven't we? We don't have a choice. I'm not sitting up here saying, well, you know, God did this, but God can certainly use this, can't he? He can use this. He can use this to say, listen, it's time to get your priorities straight. Why are you doing what you're doing? Why are you living the way you're living? What benefit is it for you to gain and gain and gain and strive for whatever that is that you're trying to achieve? And what is it? It's a trophy? What are you going to get, a trophy? What does that even mean? It's time for us to slow down, because we don't have a choice. We don't have a choice. Maybe if we had slowed down before now, we wouldn't have to go through this. I don't know. I'm not a prophet. I can't tell you why. I just know that God can take this and God can use this to get our priorities set right, to get us back to putting Him first. I want to go back to that statement that Jesus said, because it's kind of disturbing, right? I just can't leave it out there. Jesus said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." That's not what you say in casual conversation. I hope it's not. What's going on there? I think what's going on there is 3 years before, when Jesus began His ministry, He was face to face with Satan, and He heard some words that said stuff like, "Hey, if you want to do this ministry of yours and mission of yours, you don't have to suffer for it, Jesus." So He's face to face with Satan in the wilderness. He's not eaten in a long time, and Satan says, "Look, you can have anything. You can have. You can turn that stone into hot piping bread with butter on it. In fact, you could throw yourself off the temple. Everyone's watching and be caught by angels. You'd be so cool. You could have every kingdom in the world that you want. I'll just give it to you. Here's the deal. You got to play by my rules. Just play this game by my rules." And Jesus says, "No, I can't do that, and I won't do that, because your rules stink." Now, I am paraphrasing just a little bit of the Bible. I won't play those rules. I won't play the game by those rules. I won't. I know you're trying to get me to play it in a way that is going to completely dismiss the need in my life for God, and I will not play that game. Now, 3 years later, He's hearing Peter say these words. This is Peter's words. And yet behind those words, He's hearing the same theme. He's been influenced. Peter has been influenced somehow by the adversary, and he hears his words, and he says to him, in essence, all over again, "I said it before, no. In fact, I didn't say it once. I said it three times. I'm not playing by your rules. I say it again, no. And I mean it." Listen, a lot of us, we have well-meaning friends that speak into our life, and they influence us. And the problem is, if it's so easy for us to fall into the humanity worldview where we see things the way groupthink sees things, the problem is that your friends, including yourself, are contributing to this groupthink. And we have to be very, very careful that we're not saying and sharing what the adversary would want us to share, like success. And you gotta give everything to your kids and spend all your time, skip church and take them to ball games, and you've got to do everything you can to climb the ladder and position and stuff and houses and title and just it doesn't matter, just stuff. Just not God. Just not God. We have to be very careful, because we are so susceptible to groupthink, and we compare ourselves way too easy. There's this quote by A.B. Bruce. He says, "There's no greater temptation than well-meaning friends who are more for our comfort than for our character." We have to be careful that we are trading the days that we have for something that honors and glorifies God and builds our character rather than our comfort. We only have so many days to trade. It would be such a tragedy for us to get to the end of life after we climbed and we climbed and we climbed and we climbed all the way to the top and realize that that ladder all this time has been leaning against the wrong wall. We need to reevaluate our lives in this pause that we have. We have to ask ourselves, are we living for Jesus or not? Jesus says, "What good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul, it's not worth it, he says. And what Jesus wants so badly for us to do is to realize that you win at life by losing. And I want to share with you just a couple of ways that you can lose in life. First, you can lose your old identity. We put so much of ourselves into what our position is and what our stuff is and what we look like and what we've accomplished and what our likes are like. And Jesus is like, where does that matter? In the bigger scheme of things, how does that even matter? Well, our identity should be in Him. And in times like this, we really realize we put all of our stuff into things that could fade away, can be taken away from us. We need to evaluate how we get our self-worth. And if you feel like, oh, I'm somebody because, and you fill in the blank with anything other than Jesus, I'm somebody because of anything other than Jesus, you're not there yet. Second, lose your old agenda. This is where Peter was really struggling, because Peter thought that he had found the Messiah. He had. He just didn't understand what the Messiah was there to do. He thought, oh man, this is going to be great because Jesus, he's going to take over the throne of David and kick out the Romans and everything's going to be better. Everything's going to be, and I'm with this guy and he's doing miracles and I'm a rising star too. He is so popular and I'm with him. And then Jesus says, I'm going to die. Peter's like, no, you can't. That's not on the plan. That's not part of the agenda. I didn't sign up for this. And I think what we are really, really struggling with right now is not one of us signed up for this. Did you sign up for this? I didn't sign up for coronavirus scare. I didn't sign up for everything shutting down. I didn't sign up for only using one square of toilet paper at a time. I didn't sign up for that. I'm sorry, this message just got dirty. We didn't sign up for this. This isn't our agenda. And yet, again, I don't know if God is doing this or God is using this, but what I know is we've got to pay attention, because this really reveals what is most important to us, because we are like threatened. Our agenda is threatened. I have plans, I have places, I have things I want to accomplish. I am sure that I am not alone, that there are others in this room that already have vacation plans. Am I right? I have prepaid for our vacation in the summertime. Ooh, I don't know. I don't know if we're going to be able to go or not. And you, maybe spring break is for you. That's even closer. And I feel that. I feel that pain. I know. I mean, our agendas are being rocked right now, aren't they? But our agenda really shouldn't be about anything other than Jesus. And if we would get our agenda realigned so that it is lined up with Jesus, remember He told us? It's actually a couple of places where it says, don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow is enough problems of them. How could you plan for tomorrow? You don't even know what will happen tomorrow. We're not supposed to be people who have all these plans as if they're rock solid going to happen. We're supposed to be people that do plan because we're prudent, but we plan with the idea that, hey, God's in control, and if He says no or if He has a different idea, we're going with His agenda, because His agenda is what really matters. When we're so set on this is the way it's supposed to happen and we have no flexibility, that's when we get torn apart. We're supposed to be people who say, God, we're going to go with Your agenda. We're not going to put our identity in what we have or what we've made or who we are. We're going to put it in You, and we're going to follow Your plan and Your direction and Your lead. And as You lead and as You share with us what we should do in this season, in this moment, we start to realize that what He's most interested in is our character development and what we can do to the people that are scared out there that have no hope, because we have hope. We have something the rest of the world doesn't have. And what He's doing is saying, hey, you pray about making a difference in this world. You pray about sharing Christ with others. Here's your chance. It's time. If you need a green light, you got a green light. Go. Share, because people are scared. And it's in these transitional moments that we can actually touch a heart and make a difference. It's time to live on God's agenda and not our agenda. I said also that He's interested in our character development. I believe that if we allow Him, He can help us right now to become less self-focused and more Christ-focused, less insecure, more secure, less cautious, more bold, less fearful, more fearless, less self-indulgent, more self-denying, less building your kingdom to building God's kingdom, less holding your possessions tightly to holding them loosely, less controlling to submitting, less defeat to victory, less losing to winning. I believe that you could sum it all up this way. He wants us to get to the place where we lose ourselves. Another way to put that, just to be blunt, is to get over ourselves. When my sisters and I would finish playing the game of life that I usually won, they're not here to defend themselves. We're just going to go with that. When we'd finish the game of life, no matter who made it to millionaire states first, no matter who had the most money, the most children, no matter what successes we had along the way, no matter what our degree was in, whether we were a doctor or a lawyer or whatnot, everything went back in the box. We put the lid on the box. And we put it away. The same thing's true in life. No matter what you've accomplished, no matter what successes you have, how much money you've made, how many homes you have, how many degrees you have, how well you have chiseled your body, or how popular you've got, or how many likes you have, or how many friends you have, or what you're accomplished, whatever it is that you measure life by and find your identity in and your worth in, it all goes back in the box and gets put away. What really matters isn't the status and the success, the power and the position, the stuff. That all gets put back in the box. What matters is the relationship you had with Jesus and what you allowed Him to use in your life for the good of others. That's all that's going to matter. It's time in this pause to get our priorities right and to play the game of life the way Jesus taught us to play. You win by losing. Losing your identity in yourself, in your worth, and gaining Christ's identity. Lose your agenda in the way you want to do life and gain Christ's agenda and let Him run your life. Pray, God, how do you want me to use this? Where should I go? What should I do? What's next? Go with me through all this. Lose your identity. Here's the deal, though. Jesus said to Peter and the others, they just weren't listening at the time, but I want you to hear it. He said, and 3 days later, I will rise. I will rise. We can't miss that because Jesus is giving all the hope in the world here. He's saying, look, you win at life by losing, but here's the deal. You lose yourself and you gain Christ and you've gained everything because you win for eternity. You win forever and ever. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus, you don't want to leave today without surrendering your life to Him because you can't win without Him. As He dies, you die with Him. As He rises, you rise with Him. That's the beautiful picture of baptism, isn't it? Don't leave without Jesus. I'm going to ask that you come forward this morning. If you are scared and you need prayer, here's what I promise you. We won't put our hands all over you today if you come up here for prayer. We'll do this, right? From a distance, we're touching you. But if you need prayer because you're scared, we want you to come up here. Or any other needs you have, I'm going to pray for you. So this is your moment of decision. The worship team is going to get in place as we pray. So you stand as we pray. Father God, you are so good. And we have to acknowledge that over and over again, because the enemy of fear is faith in you. And I just pray that our faith is strengthened, that we grow strong and courageous in the name of Jesus Christ. That we be people who do not fear, but have an abundance of faith and are filled to the overflowing with love for all those who need to hear and to receive it. Father, for the decisions this morning, I pray you just draw people to the front and to surrender, to cry out for Jesus, and to seek Jesus. I also pray for those who need to be surrounded in prayer, if not literally, figuratively. We love you so much. We thank you for going through life with us as you do. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have a decision, come.